Everybody, I'm Vicky Wheaton. Thank you for joining me. I'm here today with Natalie Urquhart. She is the director of the National Gallery of the Cayman Islands. She's also its chief curator, so a very busy lady. And there have been some extraordinary exhibitions at the gallery over the last few years. So, Natalie, let's get into it, shall we? Let's get to the meat of it. Let's get to the bottom
of it. Firstly, thank you for pronouncing my name right, because no one ever gets Urquhart right. So, thank you, Vicky Wheaton.
You're very welcome. Well, there's a lot of research has gone into this interview.
I've known each other a very long time too, so.
Did you grow up in Cayman?
Born and raised. I always laugh because when I say that to people, they look very puzzled. And I said, I know, didn't quite, you know, that has the English accent somehow, maybe through parents and some schooling abroad. But born and raised and very proud of that.
Was it a lovely childhood here?
You know, we were talking before the interview about, you know, remembering childhood, and it was great to have that sort of question, because you don't often stop to think about that. But the big thing that jumped out at me was that it was quieter. Mm-hmm. And, you know, coming out of lockdown and for all the challenges around that, it's allowed us to sort of say for a minute, you know, maybe that quiet isn't such a bad thing. And I think that's what I take away from that time, is just, it was slower, it was quieter. I remember it as a pretty magical childhood, feeling very safe and having this incredible environment to play in.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up here as well, so I know exactly what you're talking about. I know it's,
we go back.
Much younger way in the day. I think I'm older than you. Well, perhaps.
Just a little.
Perhaps.
Literally.
Perhaps not. How long have you been at the National Gallery?
Oh, I don't know if I should share that. It feels like a very long time. On and off since about 2002.
Wow.
Okay. In different roles. And then I moved to the UK for a while, and then I moved back. But in the director position for about 11 years.
All right. Have you always been into art? Or is it something that as a kid you were into? Or is this
Definitely.
Something came to you later in life?
You know, a lot of what we do at the gallery is the sort of teaching of art and access to arts. And I think that when we were younger, that was more problematic in Cayman. I do remember taking lessons with the wonderful Barbara and Ed Oliver, as I think anyone that ended up in the arts in Cayman has, including the amazing Bendel Hydes. Unfortunately, the lessons didn't work out as well as Bendel's lessons worked out, because I'm still not very good at painting or drawing. But I think there was always a passion for it. But what really led me into my museum work at the National Gallery is history. And I think I'm fascinated by stories and history, and particularly in the sense of art, how artists capture and relay that history.
I was going to ask, are you an artist yourself?
No, but what I've done is I've been very tried very hard to seek other ways into the arts, and that's really what helped me discover the history of art, and then moving into museum leadership and particularly curating, which is an art form in itself, but it's just a little bit different.
I was going to ask you about that. So I said chief curator, and whenever we publish an exhibition that you're going to be doing at the gallery, there's always that somebody has curated it. What is curating all about? What's involved in that? And is it something that somebody has to study, or is it something that they learn over time? How does that work?
You know, those are all great questions. So historically, the word curator comes from the Latin curae, which is to care for. So until, I would say, the 1960s, 70s, a curator was that classic sort of museum professional, might be downstairs in the kind of cataloging room. They really didn't want to share their knowledge. They'd be amazing scholars, but they were all about looking after works so that they'd continue to be preserved for history. And then really emerging in the 70s, 80s, and in a very big way in the mid 90s when I studied museology, curating became really, it really opened up, and it meant that curators became not only carers of collections, but and the academic side, and there's a very strong academic element to the work, but actually putting on exhibitions and thinking about ways of making those objects and artworks accessible. So working with museums, often museums have, you know, formal curatorial positions, but more and more you're seeing the art world open up to independent curators, so people that might work in multiple organizations. The closest thing I can equate it to is really, it's one of two things. In many ways, you're like a book editor. So you might work with an artist to help them develop a concept for their work. You'll go back and forth. You might offer critique of that work to help them kind of expand and really challenge themselves, which we do a lot of at the National Gallery. But also you're a storyteller. So if people really ask me what I do, I say I tell stories. And I tell stories by working with artists, by bringing their artwork together in a theme and writing about this theme. And ultimately hoping to inspire people to walk away feeling a little challenged or to engage them in a dialogue that will, you know, last beyond that exhibition experience.
Because I don't know what I'm talking about, when I was thinking of curator, I was on my mind immediately went to a fashion show.
Right.
I thought of when somebody's putting together a fashion show and they're going to go, it's all with a fashion show, what pieces come out first, what pieces come out last. Showing the different fabrics, the evolving of the theme in the different works. And I wonder, is that at all like that? I mean, who decides where various pieces go in the gallery and the lighting and everything else?
So in a big museum, you'd have a large team that all specialize in different parts of that. So you'd have a curator, which is more of the academic. So they'd be, say we take a theme like Caymanian art history, and you want to do what we would call a survey show that might start in the 1960s and go all the way to the present day. So the curator would select the work from the collection or commission work from artists. They'd then write about it, so they'd spend quite a long time writing not just the project kind of proposal, but also the interpretive material, the catalogue, the essays, the lectures and things like that. And then in a larger institution, you'd then pass that on often to an exhibition designer and an installation team, and then you'd have a lighting expert. In a small museum, there's like, used to be one person that did all of that.
There's one person who does all of it.
I spent many years doing all of that myself, which I love. I do like having that kind of, it's like a big jigsaw puzzle. Mm-hmm. But now I'm really, for the last few years, have been very delighted to work with a series of assistant curators, young Caymanian artists coming back from college. And then usually they go back on to do a master's because curating is a very academic, it's a bit like being a university professor as well. Mm-hmm. So the expectations of the career are that you would have at least a master's, but more likely a PhD, which I'm still working towards because I haven't had time to even think about that. But a lot of our young assistant curators will stay on for sort of a couple of years and then go back and do a master's. So we've got a lot of exciting people coming through the ranks.
So it's a pretty involved job. It's not just that's pretty.
Well, and this is a big difference. A lot of people say, well, you know, what's the difference between a commercial art gallery? So a commercial art gallery will represent artists and they will put artwork on the wall for sale, but it's often much less likely to have a curatorial theme. Mm-hmm. So they will be exhibition installers or what we call gallerists, whereas a museum will have that more developed storyline. And it, again, for the National Gallery, that will be everything from fine art, fine craft. We've done a fashion exhibition, as you remember.
Yeah,
that
I remember
one.
That.
One of my favorite.
I know, it's terrific.
Izzy B and Jawara Eileen. Contemporary craft is something that I'm very interested in as a curator, and building those bridges between traditions in Cayman and the contemporary space. So it's really fun, and it's like writing a book. And each part of the book, you know, you have the writer, you have the editor, you have the copywriters and the proofreaders, and they all come together to put these exhibitions on.
So who comes up with the exhibitions? I mean, how far ahead do you plan the calendar now? I appreciate that this year has been slightly different,
yes.
to say the very least. But how far in advance are you working out the schedule of exhibitions?
So about 2 years in advance. And that's because if you, again, if you imagine the research and the writing and the sort of work that goes into the concept, that might take a year to develop. And then if you're working with artists, like we're, right now, as soon as we finish the interview, I'm going back to work on an exhibition installation. And that artist has been working on this for at least 18 months. So if it's a solo show particularly, artists need a lot of time to create a body of work that is of a really high caliber throughout. You know, it's one thing to keep creating work, but then you want to go in with a curator and then select what you feel is the best work. So about 18 months to 2 years, and people are always really aghast about that. You're like, how can it possibly take that?
Yeah, no, I mean, I must admit, I thought it was sort of 3 to 6 months, although learning more about the curator side of things, it's understandable. Right. And yeah, of course, I suppose with a solo show, you're going to have a decent amount. Unless you really go bananas with just the one painting with all the lights and say, that's the exhibition, that's it, it's the Mona Lisa, enjoy, there will be refreshments.
We did that once, and you know, it was straight after Hurricane Ivan, and we did an amazing show called Emergence, which was a big group show, and that was actually a call out to the community to create sculptures out of personal belongings that had been damaged beyond use. It's a very cathartic show in a similar way that we've done after the pandemic with Art Under Lockdown. But in between, we had commissioned or supported Horacio Estevan to go to Italy to learn how to cast bronze. And he brought back one piece. And so the National Gallery, which used to be in Harbour Place, we'd had no damage. And we wanted to open up very, very quickly after the storm because we had air conditioning, for one. It's just come and be cool. And I put on, just in the front foyer, a series of photographs of Horacio learning to cast bronze, and then one piece on a pedestal, and it was a very moving, tiny little mini pop-up exhibition. So I think you can create these stories out of huge amounts of work, or maybe that one piece, as you say. And of course, the bigger the exhibition, the longer it takes. So working on something like the Consumed exhibition with Mark Lawrenson, which has been such an amazing, joyful project to work
fantastic.
On.
Oh, fantastic. His work is, yes.
It really
so
is.
So colourful.
It really is. And with such a social message there too. And I'm particularly interested in work that has a form of activation to it more and more in the world that we live in. And, you know, that took a lot less time. And of course, Mark knew very much what he wanted to see in the exhibition too. So very minimal curatorial intervention in that exhibition. So it differs, but you know, every project is different. I guess in terms of choosing the exhibitions that we do, again, that's primarily driven by my role as the chief curator, but we do have an exhibitions committee. We want to make sure that we're hearing multiple voices in the types of shows that we put together. And now I work with assistant curator and a collections manager. So we tend to now develop these as a group, and we always look to maybe have something that's slightly more contemporary and maybe more challenging, you know, a lot of abstract art or installation work, and then we'll flip a show that's much more conservative and traditional, so that you may come in, you know, you might want to come in and see just a series of beautiful watercolor works by people like Joanne and Janet Sibley. It doesn't mean that their work isn't something that we can then use to instill dialogue and challenge people to think about conservation of old houses and cottages, which we see a lot in their work. So every artist, there's components in every artist's work that we can really engage with and then interpret for the community.
Exhibitions, themes, speaking of themes, your gala nights. Now, I know you didn't get to go ahead with the gala.
I'm
this
sorry.
Year, which I know.
I know you were gutted.
And we're going to discuss that more off camera.
I'm waiting for that.
Not at all. But your galas have just become legendary.
Thank you.
You have an amazing team. I mean, Megan Ebanks, who talk about spinning gold out of anything. It's mainly your in-house team that puts those together. For anybody who hasn't been to one of these galas, they are extraordinary. Amazing themes. All the guests get dressed up in different costumes to go with that theme. The way that they decorate the gardens of the gallery, I mean, it really is an amazing gala. Who comes up with these
things? Well, they're now sort of team efforts. Mm-hmm. You know, as our team has developed and we have specialized people now coming into things like the events role, I mean, once the theme is decided on, Megan takes it and runs with it. And
she really does.
I'm going to put that on her business card, sort of gold spinner. I think that's such a great title for Megan.
Visionary.
She can do anything. But the themes have always been, and before I took on the directorship, we actually had a volunteer gala committee, Jen Woodford and Nisha Linford, and so many other people that have been involved, going as far back as people like Cassandra Green, Sherilyn Ebanks, and so Robinson, I'm sorry. So the themes have sort of evolved, but when I came on as the director, the first one that I put together was the Magritte Son of Man Gala, which was just 2009-10, I think. And we chose an art theme because, of course, there's endless histories of art and genres of art and types of art. So it seemed a pretty easy thing to say, if we use that as the base for the conversation each year, then we can kind of go from there. So we've done everything from the Surrealist Ball, which was very surreal and amazing.
It really was.
To the last one, which was Night at the Museum, which was the idea of, you know, artworks and objects waking up after dark and having a crazy party. And, you know, no matter what we do in terms of creating the decor, and we do work with Celebrations and AI Massive to kind of help us with the infrastructure, but a lot of the creativity, as you said, every year is made in-house, and again spearheaded by Megan and all of our amazing volunteers, because they work through the weekend for weeks before these galas, which is why we're quite happy to have a break this year. But it's the guests themselves. I mean, every year, no matter how impressive the decor, it's really the guests that become the central, you know, focus. And, you know, we're continually impressed by how much creativity there is, even with the lawyers and the bankers and the accountants, right? Gosh. Big kudos to all of them.
Pigeonholing.
Absolutely. it's amazing. And we joke that it's a bit of an anti-gala because we don't like to sit down and have a set meal. It's about, you know, fundraising for National Gallery Education, having some fun doing it with our amazing auctioneer who comes every year, Miss Victoria Wheaton. I don't know if you've met her.
Very
fabulous.
She's a big mouth, opinionated individual.
Which works perfectly for auctions. And, you know, it's such a great collaboration with you and so many different volunteers and local artisans and artists. It's a lot of fun. And then we always want to make sure we have at least 2 hours to dance. And that's because I love dancing myself.
Yeah. But it is. Yeah. It turns into a living work of art.
Yeah, it really does.
Everybody moving around.
It really does.
It's amazing. It's live theatre.
Yeah.
What was your favourite theme thus far?
Well, I think Night at the Museum, in terms of how the entire night went, in terms of feedback. You know, some people like the table sit down because they have clients that they want to bring. Some people really don't want to do that. So this year we did a bit of both. Everyone had a kind of lounge seating for their group. So we were able to get that really nice balance of both. So from an organizational standpoint, it was amazing. Funnily enough, the year that we had torrential crazy rain, which was the Art of Fashion disaster in terms of trying to keep everyone dry, but we had the most remarkable fashion show during it, which still kind of lives on in my mind as the, you know, how to turn a difficult situation into, you know, making the best of something. So I think that was pretty cool too, despite the rain.
I was going to ask you, have you had any disastrous things that you can remember, either with an exhibition or with a gala, just something where you went, oh?
It usually is to do with, well, a couple of things. So I've definitely worked on exhibitions where, and I will never do this again, the artists that were responsible know who they are. They're bringing work in the back door that's wet, and I'm welcoming people in the front door saying, come on into the exhibition.
So it's not wet from the rain, it's unfinished.
No, it's and those are sort of, again, like, not group shows, because we're very, you know, we do work quite far out in advance for things like that. This is when I was a younger curator in the old National Gallery, which, as you remember, was a tiny space.
Yeah,
so the back door was very close to the front door.
Yeah. Yes.
So that was definitely pretty interesting. We used to do Art at Governor's, if you remember, which was that massive arts fair at Governor's House, and then across the road at Governor's Square. And that was really developed because we had a very small exhibition space at the old gallery. So in order to work with sort of many artists, once a year we'd have this huge fair. And then the year that we did the last one, the Cod Foundation started Red Sky at Night, and we felt that we probably didn't need two massive art festivals sort of in 1 month, because again, like a gala, they take a lot of time and energy to put together. But out at Governors a couple of times, we had squalls, you know, 20 minutes before everyone's kind of getting to the front gates, all the artists with their work outside. So it's usually to do with outdoor events. Mm-hmm. I think the exhibitions, we allow ourselves a couple of days contingency to try and make sure that, you know, that artist isn't coming in the back door with a wet painting. And they know who they are.
Weather's always great for putting a spanner in the works.
Yes. So we try, you know, that's why our gala is always same date every year, which is the last Friday in November. It used to be that the rainy season had stopped at that point. It's now a bit touch and go as that sort of seems to be getting longer. But, you know, we'll try and take it on the chin and be adaptable.
It'll be better next year. It'll be bigger and better
next year. Yes, there you go. I promise we'll do it. How's that for starting?
Quick question, what's your favourite art museum in the world?
Wow.
Apart from the National Gallery of the Cayman Islands.
Well, and again, I work in an art museum, but my interest is museums, museology in the wider sense. Mm-hmm. So I'm just as excited by, I've always loved the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, which is more of it's a decorative art museum, mm-hmm. not an art museum. If you remember our Art of Fashion exhibition that we did, I took the design from the fashion galleries at the V&A because I'd always been fascinated with those. So I would probably keep coming back to the V&A. Then, you know, even some tiny, tiny museums. Yeah, I have visited so many museums in my, and thank God I'm married to someone who loves design. Thank you, Sandy Urquhart, you're amazing. Designer museums, because, you know, I'm never dragging my partner with me to these things. He's equally as interested. So we spend a lot of time in museums, and when we're not here, and also when we are here, you know, visiting culture and heritage sites in Cayman.
If somebody was going to start, so final question, if somebody was going to start their own collection of art, so if they're looking to start their own private collection, and I mean, I don't think it necessarily has to be with really expensive art.
No, not at all.
What is your main piece of advice for that person?
It's a great question. I'm glad you didn't ask me who my favourite artist is, because I'm not allowed to say that.
No, I understand.
Or talk about who I collect. Again, I think, you know, I always advise people against collecting for investment purposes, because art may continue to develop its value. But for a small country like ours, that's going to take quite a long time, unless you're talking about one superstar that, you know, people go crazy over. So I say collect artwork that you love, because you're more than often than not going to have to live with it. unless you are looking to be a mega collector and then you have your own private space for your collection. But again, that's quite few and far between.
You know, I'm talking about somebody in the entry level.
I say look for emerging artists. If you're really starting out as a young person, buy limited edition prints. And not, you know, 500 a limited edition, but often you can find artists that might be doing one of 30 kind of handmade lithographs, which I have a few of, because again, it's, you know, a lot of the work in Cayman is very, very highly priced. So buy small, buy emerging artists. And I think if you're looking to be strategic about collecting, think about whether you want to collect women artists, or maybe you only want to collect emerging artists under the age of 35. It's often perhaps better if you really want to keep the value developing to have a very specific collecting goal like that.
Okay, so there we are, good advice. If you're going to choose something you like, because you're going to have to live with it.
Absolutely.
And that could be applied to so many other things and not just art. Thank you very much for joining us, Natalie Urquhart, Director of the National Gallery of the Cayman Islands and Chief Curator, I have not forgotten. And we look forward to the gala next year and all the upcoming exhibitions.
Absolutely, Anna. It's a real pleasure. Thank you so much for having me here today in this wonderful program. I'm super excited to watch the other interviews. And thanks for all the amazing work you did.
Thank you. I like that. It's a good ending note. Yeah.